Anyway, welcome to the Picker's Circle, and here we are with Tricks of the Trade. Oh my goodness, everybody's quiet. As soon as I turn on the recording, everybody's quiet. Well, I confess to Gary, just as he came in, that my first trick of the evening, I might as well start this off. I'm really hoping that John Lyon will appear. But my tricks are much simpler than John's. And my first trick is to run a metronome in the background. Can you hear that?
No.
Good, because I can hear it. If you can't hear it, that means you'll just think I'm on time naturally.
But I don't have my earbuds in.
Well, there you go.
Bets are off.
So anyway, since I've got to do tricks and I know I've got a metronome going and I've been working on something difficult for a while, I'm going to try and play something that's kind of hard, and I hope I get away with it. And if I don't get away with it, I have another trick. But anyway, here we go. Okay, everybody's on mute, and this is Take the A Train. So that's two for the evening, and I'm going to give it over to Gary. I'm sure he's got something for us.
The same shirt. You know, when I read this would be Tricks of the Trade, wear the same shirt didn't come to mind, I have to say. Your surprises are endless, Charles. That's fantastic. And you just played a song, an entire song, where I don't think I recognized a single chord. This is how I learn. You know, I'm watching your left hand like crazy saying, what on earth are you doing up there for me? Okay, so a trick wanted to have us consider is related to songwriting as much as it is to just song playing. I think it is relevant to both. But for me, in songwriting, it's quite important. And that is a part of a song called the bridge. So a bridge, the way I use the term bridge, means it's a passage, usually no longer than one of the verses, maybe shorter, not really long, typically using a different chord pattern than the verses or the chorus. So there's a change, and that change is intended in part to break up the pattern of the song so that you keep an audience's attention. That's what a bridge means to me. We're going to take a look at a song that ostensibly is in the key of D. My capo's on the third fret, so the truth of the matter is it's in the key of F. But never mind that. We'll just use a D chord progression. So the three chords that are most important, just in basics, of course, we typically call them, if we're guitar players, 1, 4, and 5. 1 is the D, 4th is the G, and the 5th is the A. If you know the language of music theory, this gets called the tonic chord. This gets called the subtonic, subdominant, and this one's called the dominant chord. So we can write our songs and we can just... and we can go around and maybe there's a melody that goes with that and on we go. Each one of those chords has a minor chord that's related to it, which, again, in the language of music theory, as you may know, is called the relative minor. So D's relative minor is B minor. G's relative minor is E minor. And A's relative minor is F sharp minor. On a guitar, to find a relative minor, you go down 3 frets and play the minor. So if it's G, and you go down 3 frets, there's the relative minor, and that will work. That works all up and down the piano or the guitar. The reason why relative minors, it turns out, become important to me as a songwriter is, it turns out that's my trick. I rely on going to a relative minor very often when I write the bridge. It's not uncommon for me to like the bridge the best, partly because it just feels more clever, even though it really isn't. And sometimes it turns out that I try to say the most important thing in the bridge because I think that's when people are listening the most. Just before I do that, I need to just flag the bridge. So A, this dominant chord, remember its relative minor is F sharp minor. And that's going to be the start of the bridge for this song. So you hear this going, and then the bridge goes, that's the start of the bridge. You'll have no trouble recognizing it. It's about as subtle as a sledgehammer, but you get the idea. Okay. Like a wisp of winter air, or the days of misspent youth, like a choking swirl of chimney smoke, this thing called modern truth, as elusive as a fly, as useless as a dare. If you scratch too deep, you soon will see there's really nothing there. Through the gathering fog, you can say just what you please. You never know where it will go. It spreads like a disease. Some will get upset. Some just carry on. And if you reach to touch the thing, the thing's already gone. Open your eyes, your ears and your minds. Even though we might be troubled by the things we find, for we must know we won't get very far until we trade these modern truths for the things that really are. As convenient as a chair, as pretty as white lace, it takes the world we thought we knew and leaves dust in its place. But are we so alone, so boxed in on our own? Or are there things that we all share that we can call a home?
close your eyes. Imagine a new day where people who we lean upon mean the things they say. Close your eyes. Pray to where you pray that somewhere in these lives we lead we'll find a better way. Like a wisp of winter air, for the days of misspent youth. Like a choking swirl of chimney smoke, this thing called modern truth. As elusive as a fly, as useless as a dare. If you scratch too deep, you soon will see there's really nothing there.
Song, Gary. Thank you. Well, my one-line summary of this is, go to the relative minor in the bridge. So I really try and boil these things down to things, to something that someone could say, what the hell does that mean? And then go and research it, and then they've learned something. So, and I've learned something tonight. That was a great song and a great idea. Thanks, Gary.
I sort of base what I've learned on philosophy from Clint Eastwood, and that is, a man's got to know his limitations. And I know my limitations quite well, that there's a lot of stuff I cannot do on the guitar. I'm rhythmically challenged. I don't know all of the musical nomenclature. So there's a lot going on there. However, within what one can do, if you limit yourself to what you can do, it is possible to make some very nice sounding music, I think. And yeah, maybe I should just get to the song.
Well, just before you do that, Don, I want to comment that what you have said to me is exactly what I always consider the mark of a real professional. I mean, a good pro never makes a mistake, and that's because, like you, they know their limits. Some of those limits might be high and some of them might be low, but I think you summed it up really well. Anyway, go for it.
So this is a Gordon Lightfoot. Yeah, I might have done this one here before, but to me, it sort of explains the simplicity thing that I was talking about, because I'm on the fourth fret here, and I'm sort of using G shapes, except that I'm using a G add D and the C with the D and the very simple B7 there, and the D just becomes this. So I'm playing mostly with five or four strings. I think maybe at the very end of the song, if I feel like it, I might use all six strings in doing it. So simplify. All the neon lights were flashing in icy wind and blow. Water seeped into his shoes, the drizzle turned to snow. His eyes were red, his hopes were dead, the wine was running low. And the old man came home from the forest. Tears fell on the sidewalk as he stumbled in the street. A dozen faces stopped to stare, no one stopped to speak. His castle was a hallway, and the bottle was his friend. And the old man stumbled in from the forest. Here's where I add a little flourish, because I stole it from another song. Just to get your mind off the other stuff, which is so dark. Up a dark and dingy staircase, the old man made his way. Ragged coat around him as upon his cot he lay. He wondered how it happened that he had ended up this way. Getting lost like a fool in the forest. As he lay there sleeping, a vision did appear. Upon his mantle shining, a face of one so dear, who'd loved him in the springtime of a long forgotten year. When the wildflowers did bloom in the forest. She touched his grizzled fingers, she called him by his name. Then he heard the joyful sound of children at their games, in an old house on a hillside in some forgotten town, where the river runs down from the forest. With the mighty roar, the big jet soars above the canyon streets. Con men con, but life goes on. The city never sleeps. To an old forgotten soldier, the dawn will come no more. For the old man's come home from the forest. All six strings.
Lovely.
Thank you.
Now, I have to point out, of course, that is a Canadian song.
Yes.
I think you had said that you didn't know any Canadian songs, and there you go.
It's only by accident, though.
Tricks. Just looking around, I have two tricks which I think are essential for most people these days, and I see that all but one of us are doing this, and that is the use of a capo. I think I would always recommend a capo is very useful. Why? Because if you're a lazy person, which I am, you tend to work with patterns, and you know, if you've got patterns in one chord sequence, you can just move up and down the fretboard, so it's very easy to change things. I also use a flat picker, I think, is the American expression. The other trick I probably use is, but then listen to Gary, what Gary was going on about, and Gary led me to this particular song because of what Gary was talking about. Because I first heard somebody, the guy that was the pianist on this song, was blown away by the chord sequences. I couldn't believe where this guy was taking this song to. It was going just where you didn't expect it to go. And that guy was a keyboardist called Rick Wakeman. Rick Wakeman is a fabulous keyboardist. And he was talking about a song written 50 years ago by David Bowie. And he played on this song. And he said, you know, you're playing this and you think, wow, it's going, I didn't expect this. So I've been trying to work on this song, and I'm going to hold myself open to ridicule because I've never played this in public. So see what you think about this. And it's got a very strange chord sequence. And of course, I do use the capo. And I use the capo primarily because I use a lot of standard chord sequences. Some people like playing, I mean, for example, Gary was playing in D with a capo, D shape with the capoed up. I tend to play in either C or G shapes capoed up. It's a god-awful small affair to the girl with the messy hair. But her mummy's yelling no, and her daddy has told her to go. Daddy's friend is nowhere to be seen. Now she walks through a sunken dream to a seat with the clearest view, and she's hooked on the silver screen. But the film is no sounding ball, but she's lived it 10 times before. She could spit in the eyes of fools, and they asked her to focus on sailors fighting in the dance hall. Oh man, look at those cavemen go. It's the freakiest show. Take a look at the lawman beating up the wrong guy. Oh man, wondering if he'll ever know. It's the fascinating show. Is there life on Mars? It's on America's tortured brow that Mickey Mouse has grown up a cow. Now the workers have struck for fame, cause Lennon's on sale again. And the mice in their million hordes from Ibiza to the north of Rhodes. Britannia is out of bounds to my mother, my dog and clowns. But the film is a standing war, cause I wrote it 10 times or more. It's a bet to be written again, and I ask you to focus on sailors fighting on the dance hall. Oh man, look at those cavemen go. It's the freakiest show. Take a look at the lawman beating up the wrong guy. Oh man, wondering if he'll ever know. It's the best-selling show. Is there life on Mars? There you go. Thank you for putting up with me.
Well, that's one heck of a chord progression.
Isn't it?
There's no way I could have figured that out just listening.
It's astounding.
Well, Rick Wakeman thought it was astounding when he had to play it first time, and he said, wow.
So, I recognize the name. Was he Moody Blues?
No, that was David Bowie.
No, Rick Wakeman. Who did he play
Wakeman
with?
Rick Wakeman was with Yes.
The band. Yes, that's it, right. Yes, okay. Well, I guess it's my turn. I'm not actually sure, Charles, if I have a trick to show you. Sometimes the things you do are just kind of related to habit, or I don't know, so well ingrained that you no longer think of them as something anyone else is interested in. But I was thinking about just jamming scales and some of the scales that I use when I'm playing along, jamming with you guys on mute, of course. But a lot of times it's just based on the major scale. That, that's the C major. But I basically train my fingers to do it anywhere up the neck, starting on the B string with the middle finger. So that would be D and E. Of course, I've got the capo on the second fret. So, and then if you were to combine that, one of my favorite tunings is the drop down D. You guys have probably seen that done many times before. And everything sounds better in the key of D with a drop down D. But you could do basically that scale. And all you're doing is hitting that bass note with that scale. Seen this before too, the combining of notes to give a little harmony. And you can work up the scale that way. I like to do arpeggios, like when I'm doing that scale, and then lots of sort of hammer-ons. Anyways, this is all leading up to a Key of D song by Lightfoot. I have been digging deeper into my well of Lightfoot songs. Don't know why I never did this one before. It's a well-known Lightfoot song, Bitter Green. He does it, I think, on the third fret. It's a little too high for me on the third fret, so I'm going to do it on the second. And it does have a drop-down D. And I've tried to throw in an instrumental at some point, so hopefully that'll come off all right. Here we go. On the bitter green she walked, the hills above the town, echoed to her footsteps as soft as eiderdown, waiting for her master to kiss away her tears, waiting through the years. Bitter green, she called her, walking in the sun, loving everyone that she met. Bitter green, they called her, waiting in the sun, waiting for someone to take her home. Some say he was a sailor who died away at sea. Some say he was a prisoner who never was set free. Lost upon the ocean, he died there in the mist, dreaming of a kiss. Bitter green, they called her, walking in the sun, loving everyone that she met. Bitter green, they called her, waiting in the sun, waiting for someone to take her home. His tears fall in the dust, kneeling by the churchyard in the autumn mist, dreaming of a kiss. Bitter green, they called her, working in the sun, loving everyone that she met. Bitter green, they called her, waiting in the sun, waiting for some.
Great song, Alan. Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Well, I seem to be next on this list, and I'm going to do a rejoinder to your comments on scales, because I think there's actually something that might even be interesting to folks that don't normally do scales and generally use cab. First of all, to Graham, I would say that Graham does exactly what I recommend to everybody who's learning, which is learn G and C and capo, and then you've got 12 keys to play in. And what's not to like about that? If you combine that with Don's comment to know your limits, then you're solid. You can play everything in every key, and you've got it. Now, if you want to do lead guitar or bass guitar, you only need to learn seven notes. You need to be able to do. That's in A, but if I did it here, that's in B flat. And somebody said movable shapes. So this is just a movable shape. And the shape is every other fret. I mean, this is the simplest damn thing that anybody could ever want to know. If you go do, skip two frets, re, skip two frets, mi, back to do again on the next string, fa, sol, la, ti, do. There's your scale, and that's a movable shape. You can move it over to the next string, and it works. It's a fourth up now. So that's where we are on that. So with that, I'm going to go on to the next. The next thing in my to actually make it work.
Before you start, Charles, I have a question for you, if that's okay.
Sure.
You were talking about major scales. You're going to play a jazz song. You won't be using major scales in a jazz song, surely.
We've got a bit of a controversy here about whether you can play a jazz piece without a minor pentatonic scale or a blues scale, or God knows there are a lot of scales you could use. And my contention is that all you really need is the major scale. And if you want to get a little bit fancy, you can use the Aeolian mode of the major scale, which gives you the natural minor, the relative minor. And then you can get, if you want to get fancy up the ladder, you can do the rest of the modes. You can go, I don't punch like Muhammad Ali. Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian. I don't go there, so I'm not going to bother. Anyway, I'll show you what I mean by the major scale and why it's useful to me when I improvise, which I do all the time in Zoom sessions. And the major scale is just these seven notes. That's the G scale. If we wanted to do the relative minor scale, we could use the same notes and start in E. But I won't do that. I'm going to do it in C. If I take this G scale and move it over a string, it becomes a C scale. This is C, that's C, and I move it down three frets, as Alan has said today. Now that's A minor, and if I go, that's the relative minor. So if we take any major scale and move it three frets down and play the minor scale, we've got a minor scale, and that's all you need to know to improvise behind almost anything. Now, if you do this, you may play notes that don't sound right. And so you need to hear in your head what you're going to play before you hit the key. There's an alternative method for dealing with improvisation, which is you just learn 5 of those 7 notes, and then you'll never make any mistakes because they all sound good. And that's such a slick trick that that's normally what people are taught when they're learning to play guitar. And people like Rick Beato learn to play it that way. Most music schools will teach people minor to pentatonic scale or pentatonic scale because those 5 notes almost always work behind, if you're in the key that the scale matches. But if you're just a little more adventurous and you don't mind making a bad sound once in a while, what you want to get in your fingers is this. Is that complete do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do? Because that's what people sing. And if you talk to somebody who's improvising, who's doing scat singing and jazz, those are the notes they're going to use. And maybe a few extra ones. I mean, they might go. And I put in a flat seventh there because, hey, flat sevenths are kind of fun and they're part of the blues scale. So if I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, flat seven, 8, or 1, 2, flat 3, 5, flat 6, I get the minor. And that's all you need to know, really. I'm going to play Summertime, because I'm going to play something, after all that, I'm going to play something that I think is going to work. See, and I had no idea what notes I'm playing anywhere.
Well, that was all in the key of A minor. Now, that goes really well because A minor is the relative minor of C. It goes really well with the yes. C scale notes, but yep. it also goes really well with an A blues scale, which is slightly different. It has many of the same notes, but it's missing a few.
But if I play the ones that are missing, is it wrong?
Well, they're two different scales. I mean, here's you playing Summertime, and I'm doing an A minor scale, which would be.
Right.
And as long as I finish on an A, all I'm doing is in the notes of yep. C, but then Summertime. Would be the blues scale.
That's the blues scale. That's right. It's not the C major scale.
Yeah, no. And there are some subtle differences, but both of them go well and switch between the two.
But for me, if you finger the C major scale and you know what the notes are from 1 to 7, and then you sharpen or flatten some of them, you can play all the notes that you just played, because in fact, if I play the C major scale with all of the intervening notes, I'm playing all of the sharps and flats. I'm playing all 12 notes in the chromatic scale, and there's no unless you want to do quarter note bends, that's all the notes there are.
And if you mess up, who cares? It's jazz.
Well, yeah, there's nothing wrong until you play the next note, you know, and as long as you resolve it to the tonic, it's all going to work. So, there you go. So back to you, Gary.
Well, thank you. I'd like to start by thanking Alan for making reference to the term relative minor. I really appreciate that. It's always good when something comes back. I may very well be one of those guys who took too many piano lessons. guilty as charged. Okay, so Don uses the term, and I think a lot of guitar players use the term G shape. It's actually a term that I had not heard until I started to talk to people in the Vancouver Folk Song Society. I'd been playing this G chord for a long time, but I'd never really thought about shapes. So that I found that very helpful. The trick, if it is even a trick, is to think about the different ways you play that G shape and what each different fingering buys you. I think a lot of us, maybe you didn't, but when I first learned guitar, I learned chords out of a book, and the fingering of G was like this, if you can see in my left hand. So I've got my fourth finger here, second, third, there. I think one of the reasons why that might have been the way you're originally taught to play G is that it's solid. It's fairly easy to hit those notes without having them buzz on you. But I think you soon learn that is actually quite limiting. The next one that came along, and it was neat to hear Alan play it, a Lightfoot, because I think Gordon Lightfoot adds that D a lot to his G's. In part, it's because he's playing a 12 string and there's a high D in there somewhere. But this original is fine. This has another level of excitement in it that you can use from time to time. So you're just tucking that finger in, and I think pretty well everybody here does that. The liberating moment for me a number of years ago came when, instead of doing this, I started doing this. So now I've got fifth finger on the top, and I think that's the way most of you guys play G now. And the reason why that's a good thing is that it liberates the second finger. And it allows to do, and you guys do a lot of this. So that got me thinking about the way I play other chords, like A. I probably play the A chord in the most cumbersome way. I don't know that too many of you play the A chord three fingers across. You'll see some people are able to do it just one, which I have a heck of a time with, making sure there's no buzzing, or C. Some go two. But this, for me, is the most flexible. It's kind of like playing G like this, when this finger is liberated. Because when you play A like this, you liberate your fifth finger. And so, again, to cite just a little bit of music theory, if you take an A chord or any chord and you add the fourth from A, which is a D, you get what's called a suspended chord. Yeah. And that is a suspended fourth. Many of you, I'm sure you'll know that. D, this is the suspended. And there's a suspended second. So you now, when you play an A like this, you've got. And you can do all kinds of things like that, depending on where you're playing. So there, that probably was what one of my old psych profs used to call a penetrating glimpse into the obvious. But anyway, it was a liberating thing for me in terms of tricks. I think most of the people who are on screen tonight have gone well beyond that trick. But anyway.
Done yet, and the weight of that hung over me, but I didn't really care, as the moment kept on calling me like bird song in the air. On the day that I turned 30, I kinda said, what now? The kids had finally gone to sleep, and I couldn't tell you how I had rid along. Chasing glory, people chasing time. We were running there beside them, sharing victories and tears, and wondering what had happened to those 10 years. Those 10 years went by like lightning. We were caught up in a blur. Was the movement getting frightening? Did we long for how things were? Staring at my age, like notes from my last novel on a yellowed page. We were walking through the forest, walking on the shore. It was all unfolding for us, but we reached for something more. We were gathering our friendships and memories held dear, and wondering what had happened to those 10 years. Really changed the man. maladies, the remedies, the memory for name. Should I dwell upon the stories, the agony, the cheers, or should I simply love the dance? Of all those years.
That's a great song, Gary. That's a great song. What's it called?
It's called Those 10 Years.
Those 10 Years. Fabulous song. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, what's interesting about that, I don't know what scale you were using, Charles, to jam to it, but that in the key of G major, all those typical chord shapes, and like yourself, I never heard the word shapes until I started hanging out with the folkies. But you can actually get away with playing an E blues scale as long as you start it on the G and finish it on the G. So an E's blues scale, that's essentially all the same notes, right? But it goes very well with your G chord.
Well, is that the same as the G scale but with a flat seventh?
G scale with a flat scale. Okay, hang on. G scale would be. And what am I doing? Yeah, I suppose you're right. There is
a flat seventh and probably a flat fifth. I mean, it's all the same stuff. It's just a matter of nomenclature.
Yeah. Yeah, so fair enough. What I know is if somebody's playing the blues, for instance, in the key of E, I'm fairly technical with my music, but I don't need to identify every note. And what I would do is I would just look for the E to start with. And if I'm doing a blues scale, I know where to start and where to finish. That's the blues scale. But I also know if I go down a tone and a half, I still get a compatible scale, but a different feel.
It's a relative minor.
Technically, it's not a blues scale because it's a tone and a half down, but it works very well with the blues.
As long as you're playing in a major key. As long as you're playing in a major key.
Yes. Well, yeah. I guess well, if you change it to a minor, then right. It all goes to hell. But
well, no, then you have to flatten the thirds to make it minor.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just a matter of what you call them, and you know. And we've already agreed that the people who invented this crap didn't know what they called them because they didn't care. Oh, and I just wanted to make one other comment to Gary about shapes. And what the fogies call shapes. The reason we say, let's say we're talking about the key of E. If I capo at two and play D shapes, then I play D, G, and A. But if I capo at four and play C shapes, then I play C, F, and G. And that's what folk players generally mean when they talk about capos and shapes. Does that make sense? Like, yeah. It's not so much referring to the different ways you can finger the G chord, which is, and you're right about that. Those are really useful tricks as well. But it's just a different, the meaning for, when I tell somebody I'm playing, somebody says, how do I get E? And I say, well, you capo 2 and play D shapes, or capo 4 and play C shapes, or capo 5 and play, I don't know, B flat. I know you don't want to do that.
I'm really quite surprised that the lack of recognition of the shapes concept, because I think if you're taught music as Gary obviously was, and maybe Alan was as well, and I did a little bit of it, then the shapes doesn't mean anything. It's just a cheat. It's a way of learning, remembering things, if you like. But I think of it going back to the, like, I suppose my root is really more in blues music, and essentially blues is open tuning, and there's only one shape, and that's the fact that they slide, and it's just one. There's only one shape, right?
Yes, which makes it really easy. I mean,
and you say, they ask them what key they're playing, you know, I don't know, I'll just slide up.
It's just one, four, and five. Yeah, that's all right. You have to.
Yeah, yeah.
So, one shape fits all.
One shape fits all. And you get some situations like John Lee Hooker, where you play an entire bloody tune in one key, in one chord.
Sure. Right? Well, and jazz.
Then and I think if you try to apply sort of rigorous classical music theory to this stuff, then it's a bit anomalous in many ways. You can do it, and you do. You start talking about the minor pentatonic scale and things like that.
Well, you start talking about things that the people who invented it wouldn't care about and wouldn't understand, but even though they can play it perfectly.
That's right. That's right. Because they had the feel. It's a question of which notes work.
Well, they had their ears connected to their fingers, which is what you really need. Yeah, I mean, people who play from music have their eyes connected to their fingers. Which
this reminds me, I must share with you, we had a guy join a band I used to play in. Well, I still play in a band, but anyway, and he played the flute, and he was a classically trained musician. He taught music at the UBC, and we asked him to improvise on a key, and he didn't know how to do it. He couldn't do it. Put anything in front of him, and he could play it. But he couldn't improvise. He couldn't improvise at all. And it took a long time to get him to improvise. We eventually got him into it eventually, and it blew his mind because he thought, wow, you know, you don't need to sort of, it's not all laid out. It's not structured. You can go where you like. And it blew his mind away. That same guy, I had him with talking with an a cappella group from England. I don't know if you guys know a group called the Watersons that sing a cappella. And he asked, I was with them and we were talking to them. He says, how do you know which notes to sing when you're singing a song? And they looked at each other and said, well, we don't. We just fits harmonically. Well, how do you do that? How do you do it? Well, you just listen and fit in. And his jaw dropped. He couldn't figure out how people could do that if it wasn't written out and worked out. And that's the different mentalities between, if you like, a folk or a blues or a musician and a classically trained musician. It's much easier if you're classically trained to learn the ways of improvisation. Much easier to go that route than to go the route from being an improviser like me to try to learn the actual classical way of doing it.
But the classical way of doing it is really only descriptive.
Given that, I have to say that I'm certainly not classical, that I am truly a folked musician. Because I really don't know all of these things. My percentage of understanding what you guys are talking about has dropped from 30 to about 10%. And I have to say to you, you know, if somebody asks me to tune the guitar, I know that the top and the bottom strings are E's, and this one here is a B, only because it vexes me continually because I can't get it in tune. But the rest of them, I don't have a clue what they are.
There's a very simple mnemonic.
Eddie, yeah, I don't care.
Dynamite, goodbye, Eddie.
but it can fight. But
you
can
don't
fight.
Understand, Charles. I don't care.
No,
I want magic. Yeah.
But it can find Paul.
I don't want to understand. That's my trick.
Yeah, you don't have to know. You just have to know some shapes.
Given that, I'll say that I still like the simple. The simpler, the better. And it is more often than not the really simple songs that really, really speak to me. And this one has for, I think, probably all of my life, because I can remember singing it as a child. You get a line, I'll get a pole, honey. Oh, it's C shapes on the fourth fret, for those of you technically minded people. You get one, I'll get a pole, babe. You get one, Lord, I'll get a pole. We'll go down to the crawdad hole, honey, baby mine. Get a pole, woman, you slept too late, honey. Get a pole, woman, you slept too late, sugar babe. Get a pole, woman, you slept too late. The crawdad man done passed your gate, honey, baby mine. What you gonna do when the crawdads die, honey? What you gonna do when the crawdads die, sugar babe? What you gonna do when the crawdads die, Lord? Sit on the bank till I cry, honey, baby mine. Now I heard the duck say to the drake, honey. I heard the duck say to the drake, sugar babe. I heard the duck say to the drake, Lord, ain't no crawdads in this lake, honey, baby mine. Simple.
But effective. Very nice.
Who are we? We're back to Graham.
Simple but effective. That's the way to go. The yes. KISS principle in music.
Yes. And not the band, the principle.
Well, the band as well, for that matter. Okay. Here's a fairly simple song. Tricks. Let's do this one. came down from heaven yesterday. She stayed with me just long enough to rescue me. And she told me a story yesterday about the sweet love between the moon and the deep blue sea. And then she spread her wings high over me. She said, I'll come back tomorrow. And I said, fly home, this morning came on to me. Silver wings silhouetted against the child's sunrise. And my angel, she said unto me, today's the day for you to rise. Take my hand, you're gonna be my man, you're gonna rise. Fly on my sweet angel, fly on through the sky, fly on my sweet angel, tomorrow gonna be by your side. There you go, two for the price of one.
Nice. Another one, but lots of intricate chord changes.
Graham, I have to tell you, I like the way you play Jimi Hendrix better than I like Jimi Hendrix. The reason is because although he's regarded as a great guitar player, to my mind, he uses way too much volume. And I could never stand to listen to the stuff without turning it way, way down. And to hear you play it on an acoustic, the chord changes are great. And it just makes a lot more sense to me. Might actually get me into listening to Jimmy this way.
Thank you. Praise indeed. Thank you, Charles.
So we're back to Alan, I think.
Yeah. I'm going to continue in my Lightfoot groove, and because this one's a very simple song, it basically works on the verses work on the principle of a G scale done in chords, basically that idea. So it's got a G, A minor, B minor, and then it's back to G again, and then the chorus is just lots of the same, only G's, C's, and D's. I don't know what you call it when you throw in that little A7 before the D, but makes for effective resolution. I do tend to ornament a lot. It's a term from my early music days. They call it ornamentation, when you can't just sing a note. It had to be, you'd go all of dancing all around the note. Well, you do that with the chords. Yes, you do that with the chords a lot with, yeah, lots of hammer-ons. And when I'm in G, I'm doing this bit. And certainly, as Gary was talking about, lots of the suspendeds when I'm doing D's. And you free up your fingers to fit those notes in. I'm often playing G chords to keep this finger free, if you can see. So I've got my pinky on the high G, middle finger on the B, and the bass note's done actually with my ring finger. And that, up that index finger to start doing all that ornamentation that I was talking about. Now, whether I do any of that in this song, I have no idea, because I do it differently every time. Most of my songs are like that, very organic. All right, so this is Wherefore and Why. And again, it's early Lightfoot, and some of you may know it, some of you may not, but pretty simple song in a little higher key than I'm used to, but I wanted to keep it in G because those are the shapes that I really like to ornament. And also it's set up well for doing an instrumental, so I'll throw one of those in somewhere in the middle as well. Okay. When I woke this morning, something inside of me told me this would be my day. I heard the morning train, I felt the wind change, too many times I'm on my way. Come on, sunshine, what can you show me? Where can you take me to make me understand? The wind can't shake me, brothers forsake me. The rain can't touch me, but I cannot touch the rain. I saw the sun rise above the cotton sky like a candy cane delight. I saw the milkman, I saw the businessman, I saw the only road inside. Then I got to thinking, what makes you wanna go to know the wherefore and the why? Many times now, oh Lord, I can't remember if it's September or July. Come on, sunshine, what can you show me? Can you take me to make me understand? The wind can't shake me, brothers forsake me. The rain can't touch me, but I cannot touch the rain. Thank you.
And as usual, I have trouble finding my unmute button watching you play. It's so much fun to watch. Oh, what am I going to do now? I made a list of things that I was going to mention tonight, and I'll just... I should mention there's a couple of things that I've already learned on the Picker Circle, notably from Alan and from John Lyon, and perhaps the two most important ones that go into my, when I mentioned earlier, if you want to go somewhere, like learn a song, you decide where you're going and then you make a plan. When you make the plan, you've got to take the distance between where you are and where you're going, and you've got to cut it into chunks. And good chunks are either a line or a bar, or sometimes three notes and a lick. And once that happens, then to make it work, you have to slow it down and you've got to do it right. And I'm going to try something that I have done from time to time that I think I'm getting a little closer to being right. So we'll see how this goes.
I'm amazed you do that on metal strings, Charles. That's the kind of thing I'd tackle only on a nylon string guitar.
Well, it was better than usual tonight, which is, you know, which means, and the trick is, that's at 90. Well, there's two tricks here. I have a metronome in the background, so my timing is really good. And the trick for practicing is to practice it at 40 and then at 50 and then at 60. But to make sure that at 40, it's absolutely accurate. And there's a guy, Justin Samedo, who's got a website, who says, practice doesn't make perfect, but practice makes permanent. So if you get the little stupidities all lined up at 40 RPM, you can groom up one step at a time. And it's, I may not live long enough to get it really good, but it's getting better. So I think that's a really important trick. So we're back to Gary Poole.
Well, yeah, thanks for that. Let's see, am I unmuted? Yes. I think, Charles, you're talking about a number of things there. One of them that really strikes me is the notion of patience in rehearsal, patience in learning. And some of the people I know who can play licks on a guitar at a kind of gymnastic level can't play a single song. They'll go into a place like Rufus Guitar or wherever, and they'll take a guitar off the shelf, and for a couple of minutes it's just absolutely stunning what their left hand's doing. And then it turns out they can't play a song through. And I think what's happening sometimes is they know their strength and they just keep doing their strength over and over and over again. And the idea of slowing down and doing what you were talking about drives him nuts. I once knew a really good musician who just didn't have the patience for three takes in a rehearsal. You try it twice, let's move, we got to move on to something else. You're driving me nuts here wanting to do this song again. And the flip side of that is people who love the rehearsal as much as they love the performance. The whole process of doing what you were talking about, take it to 40, take it to 60, well, back to 40, don't have it yet. Oh, all of that. That's so to hear you talk about that, Charles, really rings, rings true. And it's a neat way of looking at it. Just a sec.
Well, I should just mention it again that I got this trick from basically from John Lyon and Alan, who spent a couple of minutes talking about it a few months ago, and it's really helped me a lot.
Yeah, you know, watching Alan play, I might think, well, you know, he's just a natural. He picks up the guitar and his hands move and everything happens. And maybe that's true, Alan. I don't know. I don't know you well enough. But the fact of the matter is, whether it be with musicians or some of the athletes I've had a chance to work with over the years, the ones who look the most gifted are actually the ones who put in the most work. So my best guess, when I see hands like the ones I'm seeing tonight on the screen going up and down, there's probably more hours than you can count behind it. That's the case for me. Sometimes you don't know, but you wouldn't know it. But okay, quickly then, because I'm watching the clock a bit. I've played a couple of songs that, in which afterwards people have said to me, was that open tuned? And it wasn't. And I realized when I was asked that question that the chords that I chose to play actually created a sense of open tuning without me having to open tune the guitar. There are a number of things that open tuning does. The most common thing open tuning does, oddly, as you probably know, is it actually creates a degree of redundancy. So when you open tune to G or to D, you've got way more notes, way more D's than you had before, or way more A's than you had before, and then you work with those. If we want to take that piece of logic, that in some cases open tuning takes advantage of the droning redundancy, and I don't say droning in a negative way there, the Joni Mitchell kind of droning that is just fantastic. Then you might take an E chord, and I'm not open tuned, I'm regularly tuned, of course. And then if you find other notes along the neck that also give you an E, but that also create some redundancy, like there are fewer notes there. But then when you play it with that, using that drone, so that's one way of just playing around with positions, and some of that's just experimentation. I'm not going to invoke my years of piano lessons to actually try to explain how I got up here. I think all of you could probably do that just if you know the notes on the neck of a guitar. Other ways, sometimes, as some of you have really shown beautifully with your scales, I don't do that, but sometimes if you take a chord and move it up two, now you've got another kind of open tune feel. And because this is B, essentially, if I take this, play the B string open, and if I don't like the A note, now I do this. So you can get all kinds of different things. You take the A minor up five. This is made a minor seventh, and it sounds open. So. Anyway, that's been a little liberating too. So I think I'll just play one verse maybe, and dear me, a bridge of this song, and then that'll give you the idea. I remember the day I got my first guitar. I learned a couple of chords and thought, well,
here we are. I didn't have to say a word, we just knew somehow. Maybe we were dreaming about now. Have you ever dreamed that your dreams would come true? That it would all work out and you could smile with gratitude. Would it all come to pass before your final bow? What if you were dreaming about now? What if you were dreaming about now? Maybe you were dreaming about now. Here and now.
There's a snippet of the pseudo open tune drone there.
Did that work out to be the key of D?
No, it worked out to be the key of E.
It's interesting because the D scale works behind that for whatever reason. Interesting. Unless I read my fretboard wrong, which is also quite possible. Oh, dear.
You guys almost make me want to study music.
Well,
you really
only
do, because you talk like you understand all this shit.
Only a little.
Though. There is a name for that.
Bullshit. We're all bullshitting.
Yes. There is a name for that when you play the D major scale with a key of E something. And
it's Dorian,
is
isn't it?
Mixolydian or...
No. It's, the modes are Ionic.
It's used in a lot of Appalachian music, actually, that idea of,
yeah,
of D scale with a key of E song.
Okay. I'll take your word for it.
Yeah, it's Celtic, actually. It comes originally from the Celtic, I think.
So you guys are so far above me musically that I really don't have anything that I can offer you at all. There's more than one reason that I'm bald. But I will give you this. There is, it's a practical tip. When you age, sometimes your nails get thin. So I want to give credit to my local nail salon, who will do these three and leave the rest alone. So that's my tip.
And if you're playing classical guitar on steel strings, that's a really good tip.
Yeah, well, there you go. Yeah, you need that. I just found that at this age that my nails just crumbled. I never had that problem until I turned 70 or so.
It gets worse as you get older, Don.
Well, that's not true. I was on a medication years ago that I had to do that with.
Is that calcium? You know, drink some more milk or something? Isn't that good for the nails?
Probably. Yeah, no. I've been trying to eat a lot of Jell-O, you know, stuff like that, you know, is supposed to work, but no. Apparently, Dr. Google says it don't work. So I'll give you a song that I just like and can play because I have these artificial nails. I'm in love with the big blue frog. A big blue frog loves me. Not as bad as it appears. She wears glasses and she's 6'3". Oh, I'm not worried about our kids. I know they'll turn out neat. Oops, neat. They'll be great looking cause they'll have my face great. Swimmers cause they'll have her feet. Another good tip is to actually make sure the chords are in the right place in the lyrics you're reading. Oh, I know we can make things work. got good family sense. Daddy was a frog from Philadelphia, a daddy an enchanted prince. Oh, I'm in love with the big blue frog. A big blue frog loves me. Not as bad as it appears. She got rhythm and a PhD. Oh, the neighbors are against it, and it's clear to me, probably clear to you. They think the value on the property will go right down if the family next door is blue. Oh, I'm in love with the big blue frog. A big blue frog loves me. I got it tattooed on my chest. It says a PH. Bounce it up, buddy. Spells frog to me.
Nice.
Thank you, Don.
Don, I hear you bending that little seventh note in there. Are you doing it with your pinky? I can't see.
Yeah.
That'll build up the pinky muscles. Are you pushing yeah, well, up towards you or pulling down?
Well, just kind of going, sideways.
Okay, so you're pulling away from you by the look of it there.
Well, either way, I go both ways.
Yeah, my finger ain't that strong, but I like the sound of it. It just sort of hangs and goes twang.
Yeah, I like the twang. Gary, you were talking about playing that A chord. I have an old Gibson, and the neck was made very narrow. Apparently, I learned for I think jazz stuff, and there's no way I can fit three fingers in there to play it. The finger, they just don't fit. Period. So I've always had to play it this way, which leaves me free to, do all kinds of strange things. But it depends upon how, how wide the neck is. This is a very narrow neck, that makes that easy. And also with the D, adding the, pulling the thumb around and adding that bass string on.
Anyhow. Bring up a really good point about that A chord, because that's something, when I learned A chord, I learned it, index finger, and then middle finger, and then ring finger.
Yeah.
But. Yeah. I switched the two top, and I know a lot of people do that, to sort of squeeze them all in closer to the fret. So I've been playing it like that for years now, with the middle finger on top, index in the middle, and ring finger on the top still.
I could do that, but I just got used to doing it the other way and always have.
Oh, no, I agree. This you can get a lot of movement out of that, too.
Yeah. Yeah. Good deal.
Good stuff.
Thanks for all the tips that go right over my head, folks.
Well, if you get one or two out of a session like this, or out of my view on music lessons is, if I went to music lessons for 3 or 4 months and came home with 3 or 4 things that I could remember, then I got my money's worth. So,
just a show of hands, how many of you have had guitar lessons? Okay, all right. Because I've never had any guitar lessons. So, Gary, you and Alan have done this on your own.
Yeah, but I had people to learn from, friends, relatives, and so forth. You pick things up in jamming, and the more you play with other musicians, the more you learn. As far as the music theory goes, it's mathematics. And I was not all that good in math, but I can add a 6 and a 7, get a 13th chord. It's easy enough to do. And really all you're doing with scales, you know, pardon me for beating you over the head with it, but if you were to do a C scale, well, that's your first, the next note's the second, then the third, then the fourth. That's all we mean when we talk about these numbers, right? It's easy to illustrate on a piano, right? Because you
there's,
can literally
it's just the something key. There's just something in my head, you know. There's like a little Pied Piper putting me to sleep as soon as you start talking about, you know, this sixth, and then you play the scale and I go, I don't know.
It's like that Gary Larson cartoon when, you know, what you say and what dogs hear.
yeah, I remember that one.
That's blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, that's
blah,
exactly
blah, blah,
it. You've got
blah,
it.
Blah, blah, blah,
you've got it perfectly. It's what Don hears when the guys talk about musical notation.
But it comes back to this issue again that you, before you make your plan, you have to decide where you want to go. And if you're not interested in going to scales, well, then don't plan to get there. You know, just plan to learn another song or plan to do something that interests you, because there's a lot of ways to get to the same place. You play beautifully, Don, and I love a lot of the stuff you play. And I don't give a damn whether you know the notes or the theory behind it. It sounds great.
Yeah, that's all I care about. It is how it sounds and how it pulls together.
But yeah. People like Alan and I or Gary like to talk about what it is that Don is doing sometimes. You know, and the fact that you don't understand what we're saying about what you're doing doesn't make what you're doing any less valuable, that's for sure.
Happy to hear it. Graham, give us something.
Let me mute here for a change.
All this talk of about the A chord, and to the risk of boring Don, from the A chord going to the A major seventh, to the A seventh. That made me think of this song because it includes that in it, and I did a lot of that, and I thought that sounds good, and I didn't realise what they were called until I looked it up. So here you go. This is a song from the 1930s. 1920s, actually, 1924. You might know it. Though the days are long, twilight sings a song of the happiness that used to be. Soon my eyes will close, soon I'll find repose, and in dreams you're always near to me. I'll see you in my dreams. Hold you in my dreams. Someone took you out of my arms. Still I feel the thrill of your charm. Eyes that shine. Here you go. Eyes that shine. Here we Don't let the light my way tonight. I'll see you in my dream. They will light my lonely way.
Great song, Graham. That one's a little tricky.
I love that old small tea.
Thank you.
Let's see.
Oh, you can't see my... Just a minute. A slight procedural problem. There we go. How's my British accent? Is it worth mention?
No, stick with your...
All right, then.
No lighter one.
I haven't done this one in a long time, so if I screw it up, you've got my excuse in advance. All my bags are packed, I'm ready to go. Standing here outside your door, I hate to wake you up to say goodbye. But the taxi's waiting, he's blowing his horn. Already I'm so lonesome I could cry. So kiss me and and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go. I'm leaving on a jet plane. Don't know when I'll be back again. Oh, babe, I hate to go. Now the time has come, leave you one more time. Let me kiss you, close your eyes, and I'll be on my way. Yeah, that's enough of that. So that's how you do it with those chords. I always thought that worked beautifully.
That was great. It said, why did you stop? It was fabulous.
Oh.
much better version.
I get bored with it because I've done it that way forever. Sorry.
It's beautiful. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, fabulous version. I like this one because it's got a nice chord sequence, and I play this because it's a Bob Dylan song, and Charles likes Bob Dylan songs. So this is for you, Charles, especially for our host.
Where are you, Capewood?
I'm Capewood on the 6th fret. What about that? Walk into the room with your pencil in your hand. You see somebody naked and you say, who is that man? You try so hard but you don't understand just what you will say when you get home. Cause something is happening here but you don't know what it is. Ask, is this where it's at? Somebody points to you and says, it's his. And you say, what's mine? And somebody else says, well, what is? And you say, oh my God, I'm not here all alone. Because something is happening and you don't know what it is. In your ticket and you go watch the geek who immediately walks up to you when he hears you speak and says, how does it feel to be such a freak? And you say, impossible, as he hands you a bone. And something is happening here but you don't know what it is. Many contacts amongst the lumberjacks too. Get your facts and somebody attacks your imagination. But nobody has any respect. Anyway, they already expect you to give all your check to taxable, factable charity organization. Yeah, well, you've been with the professors and they all like your looks. With great lawyers you have discussed lepers and crooks. You've been to all of F. Scott Fitzgerald's books. Well, you're very well read, it's well known. happening. Hey, you don't know what it is. Well, the sword swallower, he comes up to you and then he kneels. He crosses himself and then he clicks his high heels. And without further notice, he asks you how it feels. And he says, here's your throat back, thanks for the loan. And you know something is happening, but you don't know what it is. One-eyed midget shouting the word now, and you say for what reason, and he says how, and you say what does this mean, and he screams back, you're a cow, give me some milk or else I go home. You know something is happening, but you don't know what it is. Walk into the room like a camel, and then you frown. You put your eyes in your pocket and your nose to the ground. There ought to be a law against you coming round. You should be made to wear earphones. Cause something is happening here, you don't know what it is.
Great song, Graham.
Thank you.
Wow. And then that's Dylan, and he's written 500 songs, and they're all equally as wordy. How did he ever remember all of the damn lyrics to these in concert?
He's smarter than the average dude.
Well, you're a songwriter, Alan, so...
I can't even remember the lyrics to my own songs.
Oh, you can't? I was going to say, isn't it easier when you write it? No?
It's actually harder to remember your own stuff.
I can forget lyrics to songs I have been singing for over 50 years.
Oh, well, that's just age done.